Thank you for coming today. I'm Scott Casper, the Dean of the College of Arts, Humanities, and Social Sciences, and Professor of History, and I am delighted to welcome you to the annual Lipitz Lecture, which is sponsored jointly by the College and by the Drescher Center for the Humanities as part of the Humanities Forum. And I want to recognize the director of the Drescher Center, Jessica Berman, who's here with us today. The Lipitz Professorship in the Arts, Humanities, and Social Sciences is our college's foremost faculty honor. A number of years ago, Roger C. Lipitz and the Lipitz Family Foundation established an endowed fund at UMBC, the purpose of which, and I quote, shall be to provide funds to recognize and support innovative and distinguished teaching and or research in the arts, humanities, and social sciences at the University of Maryland, Baltimore County. The Lipitz Professorship is conferred annually for a term of one academic year upon a tenured faculty member in the college. Its recipients have typically epitomized UMBC's values of excellence and distinction in research and teaching, as well as outstanding citizenship within and beyond the university. Previous Lipitz professors have included Professors Carlo Di Clemente, who I think I saw here today, John Sturgeon from Visual Arts, Tom Field from Modern Languages, Linguistics, and Intercultural Communication, Jim Grubb from History, who is here today, Leslie Morgan from Sociology and Anthropology, and Raphael Falco from English. The Lipitz Professor in the Arts, Humanities, and Social Sciences for 2013-14 has been Professor Linda Dusman of the Department of Music, and she will be speaking this afternoon, as is part of the responsibility of the Lipitz Professor. I want to tell you a little bit about Professor Dusman and then turn it over to her. Dr. Dusman's compositions and sonic art explore the richness of contemporary life from the personal to the political. Her work has been awarded by the International Alliance for Women in Music, Meet the Composer, the Swiss Women's Music Forum, the American Composers Forum, the International Electroacoustic Music Festival of Sao Paulo, Brazil, the UCross Foundation, and the State of Maryland in 2004, 2006, and 2011 in both the music composition and the visual arts media categories. In 2009, she was honored as a Mid-Atlantic Arts Foundation Fellow for a residency at the Virginia Center for the Creative Arts. She was invited to serve as composer in residence at the New England Conservatory's Summer Institute for Contemporary Piano in 2013. She has composed many recent works, including Subterranea, a percussion quartet using instruments invented by the composer, including instruments derived from things in her backyard, I will say, which I was delighted to attend the premiere of Subterranea, yes, a few months ago. Piano trio for the Italian Trio des Alps will be premiered in September 2014. Linda returned to the theater in her 2007 collaboration with actress Wendy Salkind on a sonic environment for a performance of Gertrude Stein's novel Ida and a setting of Stein's Miss Fur and Miss Skeen. She has many earlier composition projects as well. As a sound artist, Dr. Dusman began experimenting with spatialized texts in the 1980s with a passage from Gertrude Stein's The Making of Americans, originally designed for quadraphonic tape. Becoming Gertrude explored the rhythms of Stein's simple language in a dynamic evolution. Becoming Gertrude 2, available on Capstone Records, presents a stereo remix of the piece. And Professor Dusman has recorded her work on many different labels, including Numa Records and Publications, Numa, Capstone, and New Albany labels. Her work has been presented in many different forums. She has been a longtime contributor to the literature on contemporary music and performance, and her articles have appeared in numerous journals. She was chair of the Department of Music from 2000 to 2008. I will share with you just a few snippets of my own interactions with Dr. Dusman over these last several months, because I've been fortunate to see not only Subterranea, but also her composition, Triptych of Gossips, which was performed by our alumna, Christy Finn, here a few months ago. Last fall, her iPad app, Symphony Interactive, Had a major test run at our UMBC.
May I have your attention, please? Kristen Cooper, please come to circulation. Please come to the circulation desk.
If Kristen Cooper is here, please go to the circulation desk. And I should just say that whenever I attend a performance in the Department of Music, by faculty or by students, I see the fruits of Linda Dusman's work in the community of the department that is always present, and in the department's focus on new music, in which it really is a pioneer among music departments. So in every way, in her scholarship, in her teaching, and in her contributions to our community, Linda Dusman has been a fine Lipitz professor and has been a fine member of our community for many years. It is my pleasure to welcome her today for her lecture, which is called Composition as Discovery. Linda Dusman.
So much for being here, and I also want to thank Dean Casper for that wonderful introduction, and also Jessica Berman and her crew at the Drescher Center for sponsoring this event today. And most especially, I want to thank my wonderful colleagues and students in the Department of Music, who are always an incredible source of inspiration for my work. And especially Patrick Crossland, who is here with us today to perform a new piece of mine. So thank you. Thank you so much. I'm going to talk and play music, and then we're going to hear Patrick play some music, and I'm going to talk a little more, and then there'll be some time for questions, so that's kind of how it's going to go. I've always been drawn to authors whose writing styles feel somehow musical to me. Virginia Woolf, Samuel Beckett, Gertrude Stein, authors who approach the writing and reception of a text in ways akin to composers I admire. So I'd like to open my talk with an extended quote from Virginia Woolf's autobiographical essay, A Sketch of the Past, as a starting point for exploring some aspects of music compositional aesthetics. She says, "Often when I have been writing one of my so-called novels, I have been baffled by this problem. That is, how to describe what I call in my private shorthand, non-being. Every day includes much more non-being than being. Yesterday, for example, was, as it happened, a good day, above the average in being. It was fine. I enjoyed writing these first pages. The country, which I noticed very closely always, was colored and shaded as I like. There were the willows, I remember, all plummy and soft and green and purple against the blue. I also read Chaucer with pleasure and began a book which interested me. These separate moments of being were, however, embedded in many more moments of non-being. I have already forgotten what Leonard and I talked about at lunch," Leonard was her husband, "and at tea. Although it was a good day, the goodness was embedded in a kind of nondescript cotton wool. This is always so. A great part of every day is not lived consciously. One walks, eats, sees things, deals with what has to be done, the broken vacuum cleaner, ordering dinner, washing, cooking dinner. When it is a bad day, the proportion of non-being is much larger. I had a slight temperature last week. Almost the whole day was non-being. The real novelist can somehow convey both sorts of being. I think Jane Austen can, and Trollope, perhaps Thackeray and Dickens and Tolstoy. I have never been able to do both." Of course, this describes precisely what is so revolutionary and engaging about Woolf's style. Her examination and explication of the moment of being opens the possibility for her readers of being as opposed to non-being. For me, this approach to the aesthetic experience is akin to moments in the music of late Beethoven, Debussy, Ruth Crawford, and taken to the extreme of demanding attention to the moment, composers like John Cage or Eleanor Havda, alongside more recent spectral composers such as Kaija Saariaho or Arturo Fuentes. I experience moments of being in music when I find a balance between my own self-awareness and the sound itself, a kind of collaborative state that does not require humming a tune, tapping my foot, or anticipating the harmonic resolution. I am not meaning to say here that music that has a good tune, a good beat, and great harmony is not good music, but rather that this kind of musical experience orients us more toward escape, taking us away from ourselves into a more shared, generic, emotional experience. This kind of musical experience illustrates for me Woolf's non-being, as it is full of the wonderful distractions of traditional music and its resultant shared emotions. I'd like to demonstrate this with a piece I truly love and have returned to it many times in my life, Beethoven's Piano Sonata, Opus 110. At the opening, Beethoven begins in a way we might expect. There's an engaging melody coupled with a clear rhythmic and harmonic design, a music that draws both performer and listener into the details of itself, a beautiful moment full of the minutiae that is for me akin to Virginia Woolf's state of non-being. Let me play that for you. For a moment. Later in the piece, Beethoven involved himself in a different kind of musical experience generated from a process of discovery. Though the third movement begins with a melody rhythm harmony framework, Beethoven designed the music in this excerpt to slowly drift away into extraordinary moments of being. We become detached from the more traditional music of the opening and are required to engage in a new way. We can no longer simply listen, but must attend to the sound in a way that opens up the possibility of presence. For me, this is composing at its best, not a process of creating, per se, but a process of discovering some pattern, some sound, some use of time, some way of hearing that gives a sense of a sonic moment that has always been available, but through the composer's discovery, it's made audible. Here's that passage. Notice in that excerpt that there was a change in Beethoven's use of musical tones coupled with his use of time. The melody becomes less predictable, while the rhythms become less tied to chronos, quantitative time, and more connected to kairos, qualitative time, creating a very different sort of aesthetic experience. I hear direct connections to Beethoven in the American composer Ruth Crawford's string quartet from 1931, though she worked with a distinctly different musical language, of course. Here is the opening of the first movement, full of angular demands of non-being. there. And then here's another passage in the third movement where I hear Crawford's compositional, discovery moment, that she's discovering something new in this place that brings us, our attention, to a state of being. You can hear in this music, I think, that the distinct states of non-being and being become more similar than in Beethoven. For many composers in the 20th century, the process of discovery becomes more compelling. Being in the moment, in the sound itself, became more central to many composers' concept of what the act of composing as an act of discovery entailed. I was honored to be contacted by the executor of the estate of Eleanor Havda, a fascinating American composer who died suddenly in 2009, who inquired, or at least the executor inquired, whether I would be interested in adding Havda's works to the iResound Press archive that I edit, a project constituting a component of my Lipitz professorship research this year. I started this archive of music by women composers 6 years ago, working with some wonderfully dedicated undergraduate music major interns, who are here in this room, some of them, to create an online collection of over 100 manuscripts by women composers. I became aware that we were losing our history, that because women composers still have not attained parity in the classical composition world, many of their works are infrequently published and performed, and as a result, are not preserved. I'll talk about this project in more detail in a moment, but I bring it up now because Havda was so involved in what she called the sound around the sound, her composer's way, I think, of articulating Wolff's concept. Here is an example from her work Breathing, a piece she composed for 9 flutes in 1983 to be performed not in a concert hall, but rather in a space where people can walk around while listening. So in this piece, like in many works in the 20th century, you're gonna have to try to imagine that you're in a room, a very resonant space, walking around with these flutes all over the place. We have a stereo image here that really doesn't suit the projection of this, music as it was intended, but use your imaginations in that way. Hofda's compositional style falls within what was by the late 20th century an established aesthetic concerned purely with discovery. Breathing seems to answer the question that she might have asked, where is the music in the white noise of breathing, and how can I use nine flutes to shape this into a musical experience? I asked myself a similar question when I began to compose a solo trombone piece for Patrick Crossland. I was fortunate enough to be invited by the Gardarev Foundation to complete a composer residency at the Mesa Refuge at Point Reyes, California in January. This was a gorgeous location on the edge of a finger of the Pacific Ocean where I could relish days of more being than non-being, immersed in discovering the nuances of the trombone. I have always loved the sound of this instrument, a gorgeous baritone tenor with an extraordinary color range from almost vocal to cello-like to brassy. To begin composing, I ask myself, what is the essential sound of the trombone? What is its sonic identity? It's an instrument I've never played. So for every composer who's writing for an instrument they've never played, you kind of have to start there, I think. And as I studied what the instrument can do, and for this process of discovery, I'm really grateful to Patrick for his collaborative spirit. He has such a mastery of the instrument, and he has a wonderful imagination for its potentials. So he was a wonderful reference as I was working on this piece. So as I was studying the trombone, I became fascinated with the fact that trombonists must constantly adjust, and they are taught from their very first lessons to do this. They must adjust to equal temperament, a tuning system developed in the 18th century basically to enable keyboard instruments to be able to play in 24 different major and minor keys. Strange, no? Many books have been written about this topic of what we in the West have called microtonality or tuning, or about tuning systems. And my understanding of the complicated acoustics involved in this is really at the level of the layperson. But to help understand the piece that you're about to hear, I'll provide a basic explanation of how it works. The tuning system called equal temperament describes simply dividing the octave into 12 equal parts, the chromatic scale, we call it. But of course, an octave may be divided in many different ways. If you think here of a cello string of a certain length as a geometric line with an infinite number of points on it, stopping it at any one of those points and plucking it will create a corresponding infinite number of pitches. The science of acoustics comes into play here, complicating things in a very beautiful way due to the overtone series. That vibrating string does not only vibrate across its length to create a single tone, but rather sounds complexes of tones due to its naturally dividing itself into halves, thirds, quarters, etc., simultaneously. So each sound that we hear is not just one particular tone. When a trombonist plays a B flat, we're not just hearing the B flat, we're hearing actually a complex of notes based on the overtone, the way that instrument in particular treats the overtone series. The issue this creates, however, is that these tones that naturally occur in the overtone series do not fall easily into a scale that enables complex harmonies and modulations to distant keys without creating a physically uncomfortable beating between tones. So uncomfortable that some of these tones have been labeled wolf tones by acousticians. To demonstrate, here are some examples from a wonderful old LP that was created by some British acousticians illustrating what musicians and instrument builders prior to the adoption of equal temperament were dealing with. In this case, discovering the limitations of an organ tuned to just intonation, a tuning system based on whole number ratios, and why equal temperament, with its flexibility in modulating freely to 24 different keys, became so beguiling to Western musicians in the 18th century. So this recording that I'm going to play for you is of an organ that predates the change to equal temperament. It's tuned in just intonation, and you're going to hear Auld Lang Syne first played in the key of C, then played in the key of F, and then played in the key of F sharp. And as you'll hear, as we move further into chromatic territory, it becomes a little awkward. Hang on a second.
and sign in C major.
Into the chromatic direction, and here you'll hear it there. So people are wincing a little bit. Now you'll hear it in F sharp.
Auld Lang Syne in F sharp major.
It's a good thing we're eating afterward. Like a middle school concert, yes. Okay, so clear, I hope, why equal temperament was an attractive place to go. So that rather than having instruments that couldn't change keys, equal temperament is a kind of a compromise. It allows a little bit of out-of-tuneness everywhere, but doesn't require this kind of extreme out-of-tuneness lumped in one place. As another example, now I want to bridge into what this means for the trombone, and really for any instrument other than a keyboard instrument, it's just that the trombone can realize non-equal-tempered acoustical correctness a little bit more easily. Is that B-flat is not just one sound, one frequency, but it's rather many possible frequencies, many hues. On a trombone, which through the use of its slide is basically a set of seven different lengths of pipe, that's really basically what we have on that instrument, each with its own overtone series. There are at least four different B flats just below middle C. The equal tempered frequency of this note is 116.54 cycles per second. So you can hear that there's been a compromise made there in this tuning system. We're not talking about whole number ratios anymore if we're talking about a frequency of 116.54. So Patrick's going to demonstrate this for us, how the overtone series works. So the slide on the trombone basically, when it changes from position to position, he's changing the length of the pipe. And there is a B flat available in a number of different positions, but they all are actually very different B flats. So I'm going to play a B flat, the one that's tuned to equal temperament for you, so you can do the comparison between these two. Hang on, Patrick. Oops, sorry. Sorry. perfectly in tune, right? That one sounds good. Perfectly, yes. Then he's going to switch to a different position. So you start to hear the beating between the two, because this one is slightly flat, slightly lower, okay? More beating, slower, because it's a little bit sharp this time. And then? Yes, so so you can hear that the same note can appear. Sorry, I'll turn that off. He's much better, of course. This was a sine tone, doesn't have any richness to it at all. So of course, you can hear that the notes, as they appear naturally in the overtone series, are slightly different. They're slightly different colors, slightly different hues. So I composed this solo trombone piece that I call Lake Thunder as a process of discovering the beauty of the many variations of a single tone that exists naturally on this instrument. So you'll hear the same notes sounding throughout, multiple Gs, multiple B flats, etc., but all of them are slightly different because my score indicates that they should be played in different overtone positions. So unlike most pieces that are written for a trombone, where the trombonist can decide where he wants to play that particular note, I've actually said where it has to happen, so that we, and that he should not adjust to equal temperament. So I make that very clear in the score, that he should stay in the natural acoustic space that is there in the instrument. My intent is that the piece demands of the listener being with the sound itself, a process of discovery for the audience, I hope, as well as for me. Learning this piece was quite challenging for Patrick, I think, as basically I'm asking him not to do what he has been trained from childhood to do, so I want to thank you for that. You may also notice a special technique in this piece called the same note glissando, which is possible only on the trombone because of its unique construction. And this, for me, constitutes one of the most obvious places of being in the piece. So, Patrick, I'll let you go ahead. Yes. Yeah. Should note this is the first time it's being played in public, so it's sort of weird.
Thank you.
Just have a few more comments and then we'll open it up for discussion. I just want to say also that another type of discovery that intrigues me is the search for identity in music. In discovering this music, I was seeking the essence of the trombone sound to hear and understand its nuances from its fundamentals, unaltered by the impositions of equal temperament. But I was also seeking a kind of truth for myself, for my own voice. What is the music that I hear in this aspect of the trombone that speaks from my particular identity positions? And how do I use that voice to engage both performer and audience in what I view ultimately as the collaborative endeavor that is at the heart of the musical experience? Though my ego is of course present in my music, I never want someone to leave a performance of my music humming a tune. To me, this represents a kind of domination of another person's inner ear that constitutes the opposite of an aesthetic experience of being. As a result, I do not consider my music to be a reflection of my ego, but rather the result of three processes: a deep listening to myself, with sonic images emerging from that listening in response to the performers at hand, and all of that tempered by the recognition that my music does not exist until it is heard or experienced by an audience. There's a particular kind of discipline required of composers at this moment in history, I think, for we live in a world resounding with music of all genres, ethnicities, and historical periods. It is far too easy to compose solely by imitation. In addition, I am one woman composing in a classical music tradition in which works by women and minorities are still woefully underrepresented. Note, for example, that in the most recent statistics published by the League of American Orchestras, these statistics revealed that in one season, 0.7% of the works performed by U.S. orchestras were by women composers. So a mere 45 out of 6,249 performances. So my somewhat utopian inner musical life also becomes a feminist project of persistence, constantly discovering my own voice so that I can speak with a woman's voice in a world that does not necessarily welcome it. Succeeding in this, and I know that I don't always succeed, but succeeding for me constitutes another kind of being, eschewing the facile and demanding a balance of presence and identity in discovering sonic experiences that hold the potential to evoke an aesthetic response in performers and audiences. The feminist project that I've undertaken with Irizon Press reflects this commitment, as we are digitally archiving music by women who compose in distinct styles that do not necessarily fit popular classical music trends. This important music, a significant piece of our cultural heritage, in another 50 years could be lost. Much of it copied in ink, by hand, on vellum, or on onion skin. It would likely end up in family attics or in storage units like the one in which I spent 2 days last fall in Arkansas, finding Eleanor Hovde's materials to bring to UMBC to digitize. Hovde led an extraordinary life. She was commissioned constantly by the most important contemporary ensembles and dance companies of the late 20th century. Here were boxes of scores, recordings of concerts, videotapes of dance works and rehearsals, dance notation for choreographed works, and entire life works shoved into a storage unit by a composer whose name all of us should know but might not had I not received funding from the Lipitz Professorship to retrieve it and ship it back here to UMBC. Two music major undergraduates, Karina Ingram and Sydney Wagner, spent the January term organizing her materials and digitizing her scores and manuscripts so that they can be made available to musicians and scholars. Special Collections here in the Alvin O'Kuhn Library have graciously agreed to house Hovde's materials in their archives. There are many other composers whose materials are in similar states, and so as I persist in my own compositional discoveries, I'm also discovering and preserving the richness of the many other voices that collectively constitute our history. So I'd like to close, before we open up for discussion, by expressing my deep gratitude to the Lipitz family for their support of research in the College of Arts, Humanities, and Social Sciences, and to UMBC for granting me a sabbatical this spring. I'm indebted to both for the many days more full of being than non-being that I've experienced as a result. Thank you. Thanks very much. So if you have questions, I'd welcome them. I know Patrick is also willing to take questions if you have specific ones for him as well.
So if anyone has questions, let me know.
You don't have to use the mic.
I'm not sure that this is completely a coherent question. It's more of like a statement and you can react to it.
Great. Yeah, that's great.
So you're talking about the difference between being on YouTube and at certain times mentioning that concert. But I think a lot of people kind of think about that moment between listeners in rock concerts or more popular forms of music as sort of a collaborative experience between everyone in the audience.
Yes.
And you're simultaneously talking about your collaboration with Patrick on making a piece. And so I'm kind of sitting here thinking, it's like you're not against collaboration, obviously, but what you're asking is that if people are going to listen, you want them to be conscious of their listening, which is sort of...
Actually, no.
Okay.
Actually,
good.
No. Yeah, no. Really, I mean, and I want to make this point again. I made it in the talk, but I want to make it again. I'm not saying that humming a tune is a bad thing.
And that
is a particular kind of musical experience that I think we all value, right? We all love that kind of shared, you know, we're all in the groove with this music and we all leave and we've had this kind of shared emotional experience that connects all of us, right? But what I'm after, I think, is more of an aesthetic experience that brings yourself forward, right? Mm-hmm. That you have your self-awareness in relationship with this sonic experience that you're having, that's what we all share, right? As opposed to the specifics of the music itself.
Yeah, exactly.
So, yeah.
Thank you.
Okay.
I sense that was the case, and I think that's an important distinction here.
Yeah.
You're not pushing one away, you're asking for a different type of listening that can engage in a different way that's equally as meaningful and interesting.
So exactly. Well, thank you for bringing that up, because I did want to make that really clear. Yeah.
Anyone else? Do you want to use the microphone?
Brave student.
No, that's okay.
Talk loud so that other people can hear your question.
Yeah. Before you did the residency, had you already chosen to use the trombone?
Yes. I mean, Patrick, we've been talking about my doing a piece for him for years, and I've been, trying to figure out what to do, right? But something about being in that place, it felt right for a trombone piece. I don't know, and I knew I had a certain limited amount of time, and to have that time to just explore one instrument felt like a really kind of imaginative thing to do there, too. So I think that's why I chose at that moment to do it.
The other question I had is your idea of exploring being.
Mm-hmm.
Is that directly associated with exploring kind of microtonal aspects of the instrument?
No, not necessarily, but that was one method in this piece that I just began to think about with regard to this instrument, because it's, it has this, the slide that has this easy way. I mean, if you think about Dr. Richards with the clarinet has this complicated fingering system. You have to work so hard and find exactly the right way to do what he does with just not moving the slide. I'm simplifying. I'm oversimplifying. But all these other instruments have been elaborately constructed so that they can play in tune with equal temperament. It's weird. There's something a little weird about it.
This instrument has existed since the
Yeah. He's saying that, I don't know if you heard him, he says it's existed since the 15th century, so in pretty much that form.
Yeah.
Yes?
Something that this may be a very naive question, but so you created this for the trombone.
Yes.
Can it be transposed to another instrument, or
no.
Is it very so unique to trombone?
It's only trombone. It can't be done on any other instrument, and that's sort of what appeals to me, right? That it couldn't be. Well, no, it can't be done on any other instrument, especially those same note glisses. Not possible. Yeah. Yeah, Karina.
To go along with the same note glisses, you mentioned that it was it helped to shape the beating of the piece.
Mm-hmm.
Was that same other extent techniques and like the four tone extent piece throughout, or was that more of like a tension choice for the composition?
Well, you mean there's really low notes, those kind of subtones that he actually, you know, when we were in a rehearsal, he said, oh, I can do this thing. And I was like, wow, that's perfect for this piece, because it's really kind of like getting at the fundamental essence of what the trombone is. So that was one of the great things about working with Patrick. I mean, you can read about those things in books. There are books about the trombone, which I diligently read, but somehow being in the room with the performer makes a big, huge difference. Yeah. Yeah.
I have a question in relation to being involved in being more of the rhythmic aspect, because you mentioned along with like coming to a tune and tapping your foot to the beat. I'm a percussionist, so it's weird for me, I guess. But is it possible? I feel that would it be possible to express your individual being while at the same time keeping a group, because not every individual group is always going to remain the same. Each time a group is played, there's small differences each individual makes. Mm-hmm. So I was just wondering.
He's a percussionist, and I don't know if you could hear him, but he's asking about, you know, have a groove, kind of groove piece, and I think you're absolutely right. I mean, I think that's what the minimalists were after when they first got started, right? So Philip Glass, Steve Reich, you know, when they were working with those ideas of groove music as a kind of like, almost like a trance kind of state, right? Minimalism has changed a lot since then, but that's just one example of, I think, a piece that does have a pulse that can do that. So I don't think you have to be pulseless to have a state of, you know, finding this place, this kind of aesthetic place, for sure. Thanks for bringing that up. It's a good point. Yeah, Zach.
Could you elaborate on quantitative versus qualitative time?
Well, we know the Greeks had these two terms, right? They had chronos and they had kairos. They had two different terms that we think of as time. Quantitative is about counting, right? Which is what we typically do in a metered piece. We count 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, right? Qualitative time for me is something where that we're kind of set free of that, and we're maybe aware of time passing, but we almost don't know how much time has passed. I thought that moment in that Beethoven piece kind of does that, you know, in a piece that it just sort of is set free. It's still, if I'm remembering correctly, I think he actually doesn't have meter in some of those passages. I'd have to go. There is no meter in some of those passages, right? Yes, yeah. So, you know, he sets it free from that in a time where that was really revolutionary. Yeah, you know, it was quite a big leap, I think. Yeah. Does that help at all?
A little bit.
It's a big subject. But the quality of the experience is quite different, I think.
Is this piece written with meter?
Very little. There are a few moments. But yeah, for the most part, it's free of that. Yeah, Tom?
I was just thinking, and you can comment if you have any thoughts about this, but I think the kind of time or groove that Nick was referring to is maybe something only the player can do. I don't think that can be composed. I mean, if a composer can compose a rhythm, and there's a groove, and then so that there's either a pulse being performed or being implied by what's being played. But I don't know if you can compose what he was referring to when he said each person.
Yeah, I think you're right. I think you're right about that. I think you're right about that. I mean, a composer can desire it,
yeah.
Right? And can write something designed to elicit that from a performer, but you can't, it's something the performer has to know how to do, yeah. You're absolutely right. And that's part of the collaboration. It's so great, you know? Yeah, Kazuka?
Hi, I wonder if this might be connected with, I'm Japanese and I'm familiar with Japanese classical music, like Takahashi, and composer Joji Iwasa said that, Western music is the one, the music with the heartbeat, and Japanese classical music, like Takahashi, is like the music of breath. So this might be something to do with this, you're saying the chronos and the other one.
Yes, I think that's a good point. In fact, that Eleanor Hofde piece, I know she studied Japanese music, and I think studied Shakuhachi a little bit, and so that breathing piece probably comes from that.
And also that the Western music with this functional harmony usually coincides with a downbeat, with a pulse.
Mm-hmm.
Right? The downbeat is the one consonant, dissonance, consonant, so down, up, down, up, strong, light, strong, light, connection, but in the world there are lots of different kind of music.
Yeah, good point, thank you. Yeah. Yeah.
This has such a wonderful reflective quality. I'm also thinking of wonderful piano preludes or pieces that you wrote last year that are very expansive. And I wonder if you think about fast music and could get being that quality you want out of faster music.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I'm working on that right now. I'm working on I'm working on a piano trio, and I'm trying to figure that out in the last section of this piano trio. I'm a little stuck there right now. So if you have any suggestions, because I do want that, but a more vibrant texture, right, is kind of what I'm after with that. Yeah. He's asking about the creative process and how you know when you've arrived at a place that's successful. And you know, it's slippery. It's very slippery, I think. Sometimes I think it's great when I'm sitting there composing and I'm not aware of how much time has gone by.
Right.
Then I think I've achieved that. But then sometimes I look at what I write and I don't like it. Like I could come back the next day and it's, you know, where did I go wrong with that, right? How did I go off on that tangent? So it's very slippery. And actually, that's part of the reason I wanted to hear this piece today, because I wasn't at all sure that it was working the way I wanted it to work. So hearing the piece in public, I mean, maybe you in visual arts you experience this too. If you install something in a gallery, it's a really different experience of it than if you hear it, you know, you look at it in your own studio, probably, right? So being out in public and having a public response gives you other more information about that too, and you hope that you get better at it. But it's slippery. It's very slippery, I think. Kathy, I'm aware of time. Are we?
We're
okay. 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 Kathy, yeah.
Well, my question is key to what you're saying and Tom and Eric a little bit, because I've been sitting here puzzling over. I love these concepts of being and just the phenomenon of discovery and the bringing forward of the self
as opposed to coming to the specifics of a piece, all those things seeping in together. But I'm wondering, is that from the perspective of the composer or the person who's playing the music, or from our perspective as listeners? And especially that last one of the importance of bringing forward the concepts of self, as being privileged over the specifics of a musical piece. I was wondering how that works when that's what's driving you as the composer, and yet we're listening to get that. Mm-hmm. So we're listening for the specifics of the piece,
mm-hmm.
as opposed
mm-hmm.
to bringing forward aspects mm-hmm. of ourselves. So can you just talk about that a little bit?
Yeah, well,
it's
it's
an interesting puzzle.
Yes, it is. It is. My hope is that the music leads you there, right? I mean, I feel like. You know, the opening of the piece, and you can tell me if this worked or not for you. I'm interested to hear. So the opening of the trombone piece kind of comes from afar, right? He's got the mute in. It's a little bit more straightforward in terms of, like, melody, so to speak. It gives you some of those details that maybe you're hoping to hear in the piece, but it moves pretty slowly, right? So already time is being a little bit distorted. But it's also got high notes, right? So it's a high frequency. There's a kind of brightness there. And then I'm hoping that you kind of let go of that after, you know, you get comfortable with that sound and then kind of let go of that. And then maybe return to it at the end. There is a kind of ABA-ness about this, like, you know, there's a beginning, middle, and end feeling about it. And at the end, it returns, like, kind of, I said to Patrick, like, just in case I didn't get it, Here it is again, all those B flats, you know, lined up one by the other, so that you can kind of latch on to that at the ending, is what I was hoping. But it's kind of experimental, you know, it's my research, you know, it's where I'm trying to sort this out for myself. It's a good question.
I think we have time for one more question.
Yeah, Eve?
I just wanted to ask a person, how would you hear more of Pablo's music, for example? So you did all this running through her.
Yeah.
The things to be read it, and it's here in manuscript, and there's some recordings. Like, that's a period, that's a recording from her lifetime.
Right? Yes, that's right. That's right.
So if we wanted to hear more, aside from what you've collected here in the library, does it have to be played?
No, there are a couple of recordings of her music that are out.
Okay.
So there are a few pieces that have been recorded. This is one of them.
Okay.
But there are many, many more that haven't.
Right.
So yeah, they're available. You know, I can tell you the labels and stuff if you're interested. And in fact, there's one great set that actually includes, on the CD, there are some, it's an enhanced CD, so there are some scores there as well as the audio. So that's a really great collection. But that just came out like a year ago. It's, you know.
Can I just follow up on that? Mm-hmm. So is part of that project that you're doing, the collecting the women composers' materials,
mm-hmm.
do you have, is it, it's a repository, obviously, but do you have a dream of getting that music into the marketplace so that it does, so there's more than 0.7%? I mean, there's obviously living composers, too, right?
Yes, yeah.
I take it that you're collecting ladies from the 20th century.
Yes, that's right. That's right.
So how are you... is that part of the project?
Yeah. Yeah, absolutely. I mean, my hope is, you know, you can build it, but they don't necessarily come, right? So my hope, though, is that by making the music available online, Nancy, last year did a student performance of a number of the works from the collection, and there are, you know, people are downloading them, so we have had some people that have expressed an interest that way, and then, you know, doing that marketing end of things is the challenging piece of it. But I just came into an agreement with Numa Records and Publication. They're going to start marketing for us.
Okay.
So that's great, because that's not really something I know how to do.
Right.
So, but yeah, it's kind of making these connections with people who do that has been a great step forward. Yeah. Okay, great. Well, thank you so much.
Many thanks to Linda Dusman for this lecture, to Patrick Crossland for being part of this. This has been our last Humanities Forum lecture for this semester, so please look for the announcement of fall events coming soon. I'm also very happy to announce that the Lipitz Professor in the Arts, Humanities, and Social Sciences for 2014-2015 will be Dr. Devin Haggerty, Professor of Political Science and Director of the Global Studies Program, who is here with us today. Dr. Haggerty is an internationally recognized scholar of South Asian international relations, both India-Pakistan relations and South Asia-US relations. He came to UMBC from the University of Sydney in 2001, and since then he's published 2 books, 5 articles, and 13 book chapters, as well as founding the journal Asian Security in 2003. He teaches courses in international relations and has won the Political Science Department's Teacher of the Year Award 3 times. He has served as chair of the Political Science Department. He currently chairs one of the working groups for the university's strategic planning process, and his list of contributions to UMBC is quite voluminous. He is notably currently the founding director of the Global Studies Program, which after less than 1 year has more than 50 majors here at UMBC. During his Lipitz year, Professor Haggerty will continue work on a book project entitled Fear, Ambition, and the Sturdy Child of Terror, South Asia's Triangular Nuclear Dilemma. We will look forward to hearing more about this in next year's Lipitz lecture. I invite you to join me for refreshments and for more conversation with Professor Dusman in the little reception we have right behind us. And thanks so much for coming.